We're so glad you've joined us today to worship. This is Palm Sunday, if you didn't remember. And on that day so long ago, as Jesus rode into town, the children, the adults shouted out, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." Hosanna means save now. This morning we'd like to stand and sing and remind ourselves that this is the only Jesus, the only one. He's the one we've asked to save us. To love on and remember the investment that Randy and Pam have made and will continue to make here at First Baptist, it's so much more important to remember who it is that called them, and shaped them, empowered them to serve in this place for the last 35 years. The same Jesus died for you and died for me. The same one that allows us to call him Lord and to worship him. The same one that extends his grace to all the nations. This one, Jesus, is the one we worship. Let's worship as we sing.
To your arms.
celebrate, we remember Jesus didn't stay in the grave. Cursed open and defeated death in the grave. Sing this out.
My heart, every word that you speak, I need you, Lord, come find me. Holy Spirit, breathe. I've been walking through deserts. I need more of your presence. I'm weak. Savior, be my strength. Down
to that cross for us, and that it didn't stop there. You burst forth from the tomb. You sealed for us power over sin and power over death. Thank you for being not just a great man, but being our Savior, our resurrected Lord. And Lord, we thank you too that this is not all there is, but that you are our returning King. And even as we look around the world and we don't like a lot of what we see, we pray, God, this prayer of the ancients, Maranatha, come quickly, God. Even so, come, regardless of all that's going on. Please come. Come soon. That's our cry, God. It's our prayer. Hear us. Shout it out to you.
We wait for you.
Amen. So be it. Lord, have a seat.
Thank you, Ken. Guys, I can think of no better lead-in to today's message, being the church, because that is vastly different. Being the church, being the people of God, that is a vast difference between being a religious people. It might surprise you, but I've never really considered myself to be religious. I've never considered myself to be a religious person. In fact, it was a very strong dislike that I've always had for religious people. These religious people were the ones in high school and college were the ones that were always telling me I needed to get my life right with the Lord. Never mind they were doing the same things that I was doing, that they were shocked and appalled that I didn't get up and go to church on Sunday. So I've always had a bit of a disdain and dislike for religious people and the duplicity and the lack of Jesus that I really saw in their life. I didn't know a great deal about Christianity, but I knew they weren't it. I knew it had to be something that looked different from them because they look just like me. And I guess the only thing that would equal my disdain and my dislike for religious people is the disdain and the dislike that religious people have always had for me. That seems to be the people, the crowd I've always had trouble connecting with wherever I've served is those that are really religious. Well, I'm not religious. I'm a devoted follower of Jesus Christ, and there is a difference between the two. Nowhere is this more evident than this week that we're entering into, the Passion Week. This is Palm Sunday. Palm Sunday initiates the week of Passion, all the events that lead up to the crucifixion of Jesus. And if you really understand the life of Jesus and his conflict with the religious crowd, then you will know that what's at stake here is something that is very significant. Because killing Jesus, the crucifixion of Jesus, killing Jesus is the last stand of religion in its fight to survive. For religion to flourish, for religion to continue to pacify people, for religion to continue to salve the conscience of people, for religion to survive, Jesus has to be dead. There can be no cross. So you have to remove Jesus. If religion is going to satisfy us, then there can be no Jesus. You have to kill him if religion is really going to have its day. Nowhere is this conflict more evident than in John's Gospel, chapter 7. And it's telling in the first verse where it says, after these things, Jesus was walking into Galilee, for he was unwilling to walk into Judea because the Jews were seeking to kill him. The Jews were seeking to kill him. Now, don't make this some kind of anti-Semitic proof text, because the reality is that Jesus is laying down his life. And the reality is Jews had nothing to do with the death of Jesus, nor did Caiaphas, nor did Herod, none of the Roman soldiers, nor did Judas. They were just pawns in the greater purposes of God. In fact, Jesus would say regarding his own life in the same gospel, in Gospel of John chapter 10 and verse 17, Jesus says, for this reason the Father loves me, because I lay down my life. This is something that he is doing. His life is one of self-sacrifice. I'm laying down my life so that I may take it again. No one has taken it from me, but I lay it down on my own initiative. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This commandment I received from my Father. And yet, the Jews were trying to kill him. The religious community, they're trying to kill him. Well, why are they so anxious? Why is there such a revolt? Why is the religious crowd trying to kill Jesus? Well, it's because Jesus is telling the truth. Truth is hard to take, especially among religiously satisfied people, people that are satisfied with going through the rituals, people that are satisfied with just going to church at Sunday, leaving it at the altar on Sunday or Saturday in this case. People who are perfectly satisfied just going through the rituals, going to church on Saturday in their case, observing national holidays. All of this is enough to pacify their conscience and to make them think in their mind that they're fooling God. And yet, Jesus comes to say that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will not enter into the kingdom of heaven. Jesus now then is talking about a kind of faith relationship with God. He goes beyond rituals, and now it's about a relationship, something that is transformational. So the coming of Jesus on the scene means the death of pomposity and pretense and duplicity and hypocrisy. No longer can you be satisfied with this. Jesus is speaking truth. Truth is always a howling reproach. Truth is never a polite tap on the shoulder, Charles Colson said. Truth is always a howling reproach. It comes against us. And so Jesus is speaking truth, and because he speaks truth, they hate truth. And whenever you hate the truth, whenever you have no regard for truth, then the very next step is hating those who speak truth. And so the Jews were trying to kill Jesus so that they could continue on undisturbed in their religious life. Jesus was never really worried about winning over the crowd, was he? First half of his ministry, it was really cool, really neat to be a follower of Jesus when he was performing all these spectacular miracles, these manifestations of the power of God, when he's raising up the dead, the lame are walking, the blind are seeing, the deaf are hearing. Well, it was kind of cool to be a follower of Jesus. It's kind of a youth movement. They were falling in line with him, and up to chapter 6, he has 5,000 followers. After he had fed the 5,000 in chapter 6, well, also at the end of chapter 6, he lost 5,000 followers. As long as he was performing miracles, as long as people were benefiting from it, it was pretty cool to be a follower of Jesus. The crowds were after him. But now in John chapter 6, at the end, he starts talking about eating his flesh and drinking his blood, kind of a turnoff. Now he's talking about drinking from this cup, and you know, that means responsibility and obligations. And the text says that they found it hard. They found his words hard. They found his words difficult. And so 5,000 disciples have left him. Now he's down to about 11. Once again, one pretender. He's down to about 11 disciples again. And so Jesus was never really concerned about trying to gather a crowd, win over a crowd, everybody liking him. We see in this passage of Scripture what is really probably most disturbing to us is that the conflict that we see unfolding in these first 10 verses of chapter 7 is that it's between Jesus and his brothers, not the disciples, his biological brothers. But in this exchange, and I think this exchange, even though it took place 2,000 years ago, listen, guys, I think this is so much more relevant for us today, what is taking place here, because this exchange between Jesus and his brothers, his biological brothers, those that were closest to him, this exchange between Jesus and his brother reveals to us what religion looks like without Jesus. What religion looks like when you kill Jesus, when you take Jesus and the cross out of the equation, it reveals to us what religion looks like. And it's a word that I think that is more relevant to us today in our Western culture for a variety of reasons that we may touch on lightly. But for a variety of reasons, I think this passage and what it reveals is more pertinent to us today. Because, see, killing Jesus, if we just continue on there in verse 2, what killing Jesus does is that it perpetuates popular religion. Big difference between being a follower of Jesus Christ and just being a follower of popular religion. When you kill Jesus, it perpetuates popular religion. That's even what his brothers are wanting. It says in verse 2 as it continues on, "Now the feast of the Jews, the feast of booths, was near. Therefore, his brothers said to him, 'Leave here and go into Judea, so that your disciples may see your works which you are doing. For no one does anything in secret when he himself seeks to be known publicly.'" It tells you how little they really know of their own brother. He's not worrying about popular appeal. He's not worrying about being known publicly. "For no one does anything in secret when he himself seeks to be known publicly. If you do these things, show yourself to the world." Now you hear the plea and the appeal of these brothers of Jesus, and if you listen really closely, it sounds more like they're interested in being his agents than being his followers. Doesn't it? "Man, we've got to get you in traffic, Jesus. We got to get you out there where you can be seen." They're worried about capturing the market share. They're worried about the pop, the pizzazz. "Man, we've got to showcase you." They're worried about showtime. They want to get him out there where he can be seen. Listen, if you really want to make an impact, you got to go where the action is. You can't hang around here in some backwater location like Galilee. Man, you got to get to the capital. If you want to make a splash, you got to go to Splash Town. Listen, stick with us. We know what we're doing. It's about the sizzle. It's not the steak. And you hear the appeal of the brothers and what they're wanting to unveil, what they're wanting to unpackage, what they're wanting the world to see. And it sounds more like Broadway and Hollywood than it does Bethany and Golgotha. Bethany, the home place of Mary and Martha, a place of service. Golgotha, a place of death and sacrifice. And what these brothers of Jesus are wanting, they're wanting more Hollywood, they're wanting more Broadway, more pizzazz, not Bethany and Golgotha. As you continue on in this chapter, you'll see that Jesus really isn't that much into showtime at all. He says in verse 18, "He who speaks from himself seeks his own glory, but he who is seeking the glory of the one who sent him, he is true, and there is no unrighteousness in him." You see, Jesus has been down this road before. Jesus understands the vulnerability of humankind. Jesus understands our vulnerability to being drawn to high-profile, powerful personalities, that there's an allure to that. Jesus understands our vulnerability of being wooed and wowed and impressed by winsome personalities, people that really deliver the goods. Luke chapter 4, the wilderness temptation. Satan said, "Listen, get up there. You want a crowd? Man, you want the crowds to love you? You got to put on a show. Let's get you up here on the pinnacle of the temple and you jump off and man, you'll get the golden parachute. The glory of crowd adoration. Man, they'll love you. Jesus has been down this road before. He's seen this. You know, what we have to see, what we have to understand, and it's lost on us, and this is where we have to be intentional and deliberate, because I do think it's lost on us. We are so conditioned to respond, evaluate, and act as consumers that this conditioning that the culture has placed upon us, this conditioning that the culture is accomplishing on us, it makes its way into the life of the church and the journey of faith as well. Whereas from this consumer mentality, we come in here and we start thinking that maybe this is about me and my wants and my preferences instead of about Jesus and his mission. But if we're more concerned and if we are more committed to perpetuating a biblical faith instead of perpetuating a popular religion, then we have to see the relevance of this in our praying, in our planning, in our strategizing. Because the task and the mission of going out into the world and making disciples is a vastly different strategy. In fact, it's a 180 different strategy from the short-term model that's interested in just getting a crowd together. A big difference between being the church and being a crowd, mobilized for service. But if you want to just perpetuate a popular religion, all you got to do is take the cross out of it. All you got to do is kill off Jesus. There's a second thing in this as well. Killing Jesus not only perpetuates popular religion, it props up personalized religion. Killing off Jesus props up personalized, individualized, designer religion. That's what his brothers are interested in. It says in verse 5, it says, for not even his brothers were believing in him. And so what their desire to show off Jesus indicates, it indicates not only that they do not believe, but it reveals to us the vilest form of unbelief. And the vilest form of unbelief is your desire to use Jesus, to show off Jesus, to use Jesus as long as he is propping up the experiences that you want to have. As long as he is perpetuating, as long as he endures, as long as he is accomplishing what you want to accomplish, the experiences that you want to have. You see what his brothers think? The brothers of Jesus think that the validity of religion is based upon the experience you make me have. Your validity as a leader, Jesus, if you really want a following, if you really want to prove yourself as a leader, then the validity of your leadership, the validity of this messiahship that you're claiming for yourself, the validity of it is going to be based upon the experience that you make me have. And that I want others to have the experience that I have had. And the problem with this experiential kind of religion, this religion that says, my experience, I know it pushed my buttons. It was just so deeply personal to me, you know, but I know it's real because it pushed my buttons. Made me feel good. It's what I wanted. It just feels right in my gut. But the problem with these personalized designer kind of religions that we're notorious for embracing, that we just make up by the seat of our pants as we're just going through life, the problem with it is that they lack objectivity. They're just too subjective. They have no historical, they have no theological, they have no doctrinal merit whatsoever. They lack objectivity. Now listen, I know what the response is when you hear something like that. Anytime you hear doctrine or theology, I know what the response is. The response is, well, I'll take my experience over cold, lifeless doctrine and theology any day. And I get that. I get that, and I appreciate that. Because it sounds really spiritual when we say that. When we respond that way, I'll take my experience over theology and doctrine anyway. That sounds very spiritual, and it sounds very authentic. But at the same time, we have to acknowledge the weakness of that kind of position, because it robs us of deeper experiences that can be had and known when we actually embrace objective standards such as theology and doctrine. The dichotomy we create so often is that one is real and the other is less real. It's a great illustration of this. If you're a fan of C.S. Lewis, in Mere Christianity, he talks about this very issue, and he compares it to a person standing on the beach looking at the Atlantic Ocean. And it's a very powerful experience. You're looking at the ocean, standing there on the beach, but then that person goes from standing on the beach of the Atlantic Ocean to looking at a map of the Atlantic Ocean, exchanging something that was real for something that is seemingly less real. Exchanging the experience of standing on the beach, my toes in the sand, looking at the waves, watching them crashing, hearing the sound of the waves, exchanging that for a piece of paper with a lot of blue ink. And to think that one is real and the other is less real. But the reality is that if you really want to experience the richness, the vividness, and the dynamics of what the Atlantic Ocean can offer you, you better look at the map. Because that map was created by hundreds, if not thousands, of individuals who have gone beyond the experience of just standing on the beach, and they have actually sailed the Atlantic. They have ventured out into the unknown. They have charted these unknown places, and they have had experiences that have far exceeded your experience of standing on the beach in one place and looking at the ocean, and then dismissing every other kind of experience as being irrelevant. If you ever travel the Atlantic, you're going to use a map. You're not going to assume that you're fit to travel the Atlantic just because you stood on a beach somewhere and looked at the ocean. This right here, God's Word, is our objective map. It is written by individuals that have had rich, deep experiences over thousands of years, who have been inspired and motivated to share with us the richness and the glory of what they have seen, what they have experienced, what they know about the nature and character of God. And what God desires for us is an experience that can take us much deeper, much further, an experience that is so much richer when we delve into the Word of God and we see all the possibilities that are before us. But if you just want a personalized designer faith, you have to kill off Jesus. You have to remove the cross from the formula. One final thing, very quickly. We see killing Jesus not only props up our personalized religion and perpetuates popular religion. Killing Jesus also, notice in verses 6 through 8, it promotes purposeless religion, religion without meaning, religion without purpose. Why do what we do in religious life? Why go through all the rituals? Why be satisfied with all the rules, all the regulations, observing the holidays, all the observances, abstaining from certain behaviors? What is the purpose in that? What does it accomplish? Nothing. It's without purpose. Notice the words of Jesus. Jesus said to them, "My time is not yet here, but your time is always opportune. The world cannot hate you, but it hates me because I testify of it, and that its deeds are evil. Go up to the feast yourselves. I do not go up to this feast because my time has not yet fully come." Having said these things to them, he stayed in Galilee. You need to hear these words of Jesus over and over again. Look at those first four verses. See what those brothers of Jesus are trying to get him to do, to buy into the pop, the pizzazz, the showmanship, the lights, the whistles, the bells, getting the market share. And listen to the response of Jesus, because his words are profound. His words are countercultural. The words of Jesus go against every model of success, every conditioning of a consumer that you and I have put before us on a daily basis. Look at his words. These are countercultural words. His brothers have no sense of divine appointment. His brothers have no sense of mission in life. The only watch these brothers go by is the watch that says carpe diem. Seize the moment. Seize the day. The only time that matters is right now. Listen, we got to strike while the iron is hot. We got to get you out there. Man, we got to get the crowd in here right now, today. How is this movement going to survive if we don't get you out there today showing your stuff? Only watch they wear says right now, carpe diem. Seize the moment. But what Jesus is concerned about is something much larger, something much broader. They're fine with a religion that gets them to church on Saturday. But Jesus is looking at something much bigger. He's looking at a mission. Jesus is looking at a movement. And that's really what we have to have. Church family, these are heavy words. Man, these are heavy words. Because we have to see ourselves as an army mobilized. We have to see ourselves as a movement. If you see yourself as just a religious people that just come here on Sunday, if all you have is a Sunday religion, listen, that will not sustain you for life. I've seen people ad nauseum just grow weary of going to church. If all you have is a Sunday religion, listen, it's going to fade out. There has to be more to wake you up every day, take you out into the workplace, into the classroom. There has to be more that drives you than just having some kind of religion that may or may not get me here on Sunday morning. Those will soon fade out. But what Jesus is interested in here, Jesus is interested in a biblical kind of faith. We call it biblical in hindsight, but he's interested in a faith that is much different. Jesus is not interested in just throwing out another religion among the smorgasbord of religious plurality. And maybe if I'm glitzy enough, if I'm powerful enough in my personality, maybe I'll get the bigger market share. Maybe I can trump the other religions. That's not what Jesus is interested in. It is something completely different. Jesus is interested in building a faith based upon two things. First one is the cross. A life of sacrifice, a life of service. Which secondly, It's getting followers who pick up that cross and follow after him obediently. Religion is a dead-end street. Religion is a dead-end street. It may get you up every once in a while and drag you down here to this place, but I can think of nothing more miserable than having just a religion that gets me to church on Sunday sometimes, and maybe holds me in check from certain vices in life. There's got to be more than that. And I think you want more than that. Well, these are hard questions. This is a hard subject for us to, it calls us to be introspective, to really take a hard look at our life. Am I just being religious, or do I really have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? It makes us take a hard look at our church. Because there's a big difference between a crowd and church. And when you look at the Passion Week narrative, if you go to Luke and you look at the Passion Week narrative, listen, it's hard to tell the difference between people of faith and just the crowd. I mean, the same crowd that was crying Hosanna when he came into town, that was the same crowd saying crucify him at the end of the week. Same crowd. They'll flip on you like that. And so if you're just interested in perpetuating a popular religion, if you just want a personalized designer kind of religion, or if you just want a purposeless religion that'll get you here on Sunday morning, you're the one that's the most vulnerable. You're the one most vulnerable to the allure of popular personalities, the allure of strong personalities, the allure of attractive personalities, winsome personalities. You're the one that is most likely to bounce around from church to church to church, looking to try to duplicate that experience all over again. Instead of burying yourself and jumping in the middle of the messiness of congregational life, riding it out, the highs, the lows, the good and the bad. You know, for religion to survive, Jesus has to be killed. And they killed him. The religious community killed Jesus. But they couldn't keep him in the grave. And now then, the resurrected Christ stands in front and before every other religion, including the ones we make up along the way, and says, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. He's not making a hateful, prejudicial statement. He's just inviting. Instead of being weighed down by trying to figure it out, which one is right? Which one is most like my lifestyle? He says, let's just cut to the chase. Let's make it easy. Let's cut through all that. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. So you either embrace him by faith and live, or you just keep practicing religion and you die. Let's pray together. Father, we know that you have called us to newness of life. We know that your call awakens us and quickens us. Your call creates within us a new life. Your call in your discipleship gives us a new nature, one that far surpasses anything that religion could offer us. Life in you offers the fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness. All those things that become evident when we live in relationship with you. And so, Father, as we come down to this hard decision, this hard time of evaluation and introspection, Father, for some, it may be a wake-up call that maybe they've just been religious all their life, and they've never walked in relationship with you. I pray for those, Lord. That's a hard decision to make. When they have fooled so many for so long with their religious behavior, it's hard to step forth and to say, I've never got it, but now I get it. For others, Lord, that want to join us on this journey of being the presence of Christ, not being a people who just go to church, but our commitment to being the church Father, might your Spirit invite them to call them to come and join us on this journey of discovery. And we give this time to you. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.